Hi, I'm Stephen Gray. I am a postdoctoral researcher and a PhD candidate at UCL College, so University College London. I'm also a Google Developer Expert. Has anyone heard about, anyone know what Google Developer Experts are? Yeah, great. So, Google Developer Experts are basically developers. I like to think of them as the developer's developer. When a developer doesn't have an answer to a problem with one of the kind of Google stack, they'll come to us and we can answer the questions. And if we can't answer our questions, we know someone who can. So I'm a developer expert in maps, and what's really handy is there are developer experts for all the different products that Google have. Here is the distribution of GDs worldwide. There's 92 of them, and as you see, we actually are completely and utterly worldwide. Right, and we live here. This is, if you ever want to find an expert for something, developers.google.com/experts. You can basically find links to where we all are. So that's basically an expert. We basically sit and we interact with the developers. We produce tutorials. We produce all sorts of handy content and try and enthuse people to actually use this stuff. So I'm maps, so I really like some maps. Right, so let's take in a little history. This is Google Maps circa 2005, when we had basically the UK sitting there in its own and the US. Great, isn't it? Where's the rest of the world then? And then we fast forward today, we've actually got the full map in, and actually, even better, we've got Street View for the whole of the, for a high proportion of the world. And what's interesting, okay, right, how many people have seen maps like this around the web? How many people think this is a good map? Fantastic, this is my pet peeve in the world. Basically, maps with lots of pins, and Google basically gave developers tools to put pins in maps, and everyone went to put pins in maps. And one thing that really gets me is that maps, putting data on maps and making them represent something is really, really hard. And that's why I've still got a job. Yeah. And so, people may have noticed, actually, let's do something better. This is a true representation of the Google Developer Experts map, where you can actually see that because a lot of pins were actually on top of each other over in Japan, we actually have a higher distribution of Japanese GDEs than the rest of the world. So that's one way maps can lie to us. And the reason why there's more GDs in Japan is that's where the program started, and so it's expanded from Japan worldwide. So that's a really good example of how a map can lie to you. And it's not just maps that can lie to you, data can lie to you. I'm a data scientist. I deal with hundreds and thousands and millions of rows of data every single day in my job. And can everyone see what's wrong with these graphs by any chance? Apart from Bifox, but basically they have been massaged to create a story. Actually, if you look at the distribution between the two, you know, 6 million, the difference between 6 million and 7 million isn't a gap of that size. It's more like a gap of that size when you take the access to zero. So you can massage data, and it's the same with data on maps. I said making maps is hard. Can anyone tell? Can anyone spot the mistakes on these maps? Last time I checked, London wasn't near Norfolk. Or Cannes is not in Spain. So yeah, so these are perfect examples how it's really easy to overlook maps and actually have data to lie to us. And so that's one of the things I try and do. I try and make making maps easier to use and making them more representative of the data actually underneath. Again, if you use heat maps, you have to watch by heat maps, because most heat maps actually just show you population density. So a great XKCD. Next time you go out and have a look, see a map with a nice kind of heat map, given it a name, a story behind it, go and check a population density map first and see if there's a correlation, because 9 times out of 10, there probably is. Anyway, so back to what I do is my day job. So I work in a center called the Center for Advanced Spatial Analysis at UCL, and we basically build tools to make developers put data onto maps easy. And one of the products we built on top of the Google stack and Google Maps is MapTube, which is a place to put maps. You have some data, you want to make a map, you can stick it through this system and we build a map. So underneath everything, what happens is you have a descriptor to decide what the data is. You have a style, so you basically decide what colors that you want the map to look like. You call a couple of magic lines of code, and what happens is the system will ingest all that data and, as if by magic, give you out map tiles on top of it. So it's a really simple system to actually get data and maps in, a really powerful system called Mattchip. Now, it's not just we sit on top of kind of the standard web Google Maps. We actually built it for mobile phones. And what's interesting enough, we built it on Android and iOS. But there was no libraries when we came around to actually doing this on iOS. And it actually took 3 months of my time, just one developer, to actually put a single map onto the mobile application. Now, with some of the tools that Google have made in the iOS SDK, it takes 4 lines of code. So that's basically my 3 months of job can now be replaced by 4 lines of code. And so we took this premise on, how can we get people to put data onto maps and see the maps more and visualize the maps more interestingly than just a pin in the map. And we built an application called Surveymapper. Now, Surveymapper allows anybody to set up a survey, distribute it with the people that they care about, you know, their groups, their whatever, or just give it out to the world and ask people for responses. And we build what's called a choropath map, which is just basically densities of different questions, different answers in different areas. So this is a postcode map of the UK. And this map actually got me into lots of trouble because apparently certain suppliers don't like you to know what your neighbour's broadband speed are, so that caused a bit of controversy. There's a little academic institution being told by the big boys, can you take your map offline because we don't want your neighbours to know what speed you're getting. What is my neighbour? We had comments all the way down in this, which I've kind of hidden, where it was saying, my neighbour has got 10 megabytes per second, why am I only getting 2? And it was a whole lot of big arguments. So this is one of the more controversial maps that we made. But interestingly, we're giving the power out to the user to allow them to set up a survey and ask questions that are interesting to them and try and get the answers back. So I think we did good. And we've experimented, how do we ask these questions, and we've used interfaces like Xbox Kinect to allow them to select the question and that would answer it for that location. So we've worked with museums and we've worked with retail stores to actually put these kiosks in and allow people to quickly answer just by hand gestures. They just wave at the system and then they select their answer and it puts it into Surveymapper. So we built these, you know, behind the scenes you have all these tools just to simplify actually putting data onto maps. And we also built a system called Gemma. Now, Gemma is our little friendly gerbil, again, trying to make it fun and interesting. And what we did is we took the power of Google Maps and the Places API, which is a way to get business addresses and whatnot, and the data from OpenStreetMap, which is an open source version of map data that we can access, and confuse them all together into one system where you can basically bring a map together and print it out for reports. So, for example, this is the distribution of bus stops in blue with where people commute. So the layer hasn't come out very well, but in the back you have different areas from the census data of how people recommend their commuting and the distribution with their bus stops. So again, we've built and fused this together on top of Google Maps to actually make to allow people to print out these maps. Also, we've put a mobile aspect onto it. We're allowing a lot of geography. We identified very early a lot of geography students have to go out and actually count things. And so we built a nice fun app to allow them to go out and count things. So they select what they're wanting to count. They get 4 little boxes, or you can say up to, I think it's 8 different counting squares. So if you want to go out and count cars, you can represent each other, and that then loads that data straight up into Fusion Tables, up into now Google Spreadsheets, and then allows you to have the data. So you have that data, the data belongs to you, and then you visualize it back into Gemma. So again, allowing people to go out, collect the data that's important to them, and collect it in a group of people, come back onto the map and distribute it via reports, PDFs, whatever, or a nice web map. And again, we do this using the MapTube libraries and a couple of simple lines of code. There you go, there's a heat map from what looks like about 2 lines of code. And now actually, as of about 4 weeks ago, that's now redundant because Google now just built a visualization library to make it even simpler to make a heat map, which was the original heat map that I just showed you. So again, you can build these chloroplast maps really easy just by skipping a data file and sending it back in. So, what's the point to all this? One of the things is about collecting data and getting data out. My research at university is looking at how do we collect data in a massive scale. So I built this thing called the Tweetometer. Now, the Tweetometer basically collects data from Twitter and allows you to visualize to collect the data and actually basically try and understand how we use the city, how we use the world through social media. I built this in about 5 minutes. It's just a simple visualization to see what my single server was doing when I wasn't looking at it, to make sure it was still running, because when I originally built it, it was a bit flaky, it was going up and down. We have this, and so it's a couple of, it ended up being 16 dials using Google visualization tools that just basically sit and tell me how many tweets per minute are coming into the system. Now this was just for me. I built this for me and no one else. And it turns out that people quite like the idea of turning digital data into analog data. So we built a couple of meters that we had spare in one of my colleague's sheds. We put it together and we actually made an analog version. This ended up going into the British Library. So the British Library said, this is amazing, can we have it in our growing knowledge exhibition? We're like, yeah, sure. It's just looking at my server. It's just making sure that I'm getting data from my research. What do you want? Why do you want that in your exhibition? And that was all right. And then something kind of crazy happened. Oops. I thought the video will play. Basically, during the Japanese tsunami, CNN picked it up and, I don't know if we can hear it, but basically used it in the reports for the whole day. So we went from something that took 5 minutes to have global exposure that was used in the time of crisis. And it was really actually very interesting because from the tweets, we could see the actual distribution of messages going from one side of the ocean to the other. So, for example, people were worried about the tsunami wave going to hit San Francisco. So they were tweeting, and when the wave came past Honolulu, people in Hawaii said, we're absolutely fine, it's great, you know, don't worry, it's fine. So you can actually see the spikes of data coming over Honolulu and coming over into as the world woke up to actually hear the news. And so that was something where we took a very simple visualization, but it had real impact. And that's one thing that I'm really kind of engaged about, of trying to get this. But we had a big issue. Once we got all this media attention, Stephen Fry, who some of you might know, has 3-4 million followers, and Alicia Milano basically tweeted this. And we basically, on our servers, got something about like 12 million hits in the space of 4 or 5 hours, which was absolutely insane. So we had to sit very carefully and work out how we're going to keep our single server in our academic cupboard. And it was basically manned by me and my colleague, and how do we actually build? So we had to actually build a better system. And this is where we went to. We went from a system where we had one or two machines going in that rack, and then we scaled it up to the UCL system. But then we found the UCL system, we have a bit of a problem. We have to share it with other researchers, unfortunately. And one thing you learn about academics very quickly is we don't like to share. So we had to think of a better way of doing this. So we decided to scale up again. So this is one of Google's data centers with their expert security solution sitting there. But basically, we had to think of a way of how do we scale this up. And so we used Google Compute Engine in the cloud to basically fire up machines to collect data from all of the UK. So what you have here is each postcode area in the UK being served by one compute engine, and we tell it to the one component of code that we have that we wrote to collect this data from social media networks and fuse it together. We tell it to run, and you see it just spin up from the hole. So this was a video over 20 minutes of where we spun up 650 machines for the whole of the UK, and then spun them collected for a period of time, so I think it was like 2 hours, and then spun them down again. So we got, we went from collecting just from one machine, maybe 1.4 million Twitter messages over a weekend, to actually having a database of something like 36 million tweets over 3 hours. So we basically had scaled up very, very quickly using the tools that you developers can actually use within the Google stack. And what was really interesting is just we did some visualizations, and what's really interesting from these visualizations from this is you can actually tell from the fusion of social media data, so this is Facebook, this is Google+, this is Twitter data with a geospatial aspect to it, you can actually start to see how we use the city. And if you look at the top corner, that's actually roadworks between Rickmansworth and Watford for the period of time, so people were sitting there saying, why am I in traffic? This is crazy. We also did some really great visualizations to prove that people, this is basically people will use their mobile phones on the runway of airports when they're told to switch their mobile phones off. We've got concurrent proof to that. We can actually show that on a map where we've got a whole concentration of data of people tweeting on the runway. So unless people are actually standing on the runway tweeting, then we actually know they're actually using their phones. But we can use these tools and these data to actually tell a compelling story of how we use our city. So that's me. If you want to get in contact, I'm plus Stephen Gray on Google+, and there's my website, and there you go. Thank you very much.